There are three main types of emergency parachutes used in hang gliding, paragliding and paramotoring. But what actually are the differences? If you're in the market for buying one at the moment, what should you consider while buying one? Or if you have just bought one, you should know what to expect. And that's what we're going to talk about today. Welcome to Flight Coach. My name is Bas van Duin and it is my mission to help you get more out of life and your flying career through having less stress and more skills. Today we're going to talk about the three most popular kind of emergency parachutes. The round one, the square one and the Rogallo one, the steerable emergency parachute. For those of you familiar with the channel, you might notice something is missing. Yep, I shaved my beard and I'm already regretting it. So let's not talk about that any further. I know that I'm looking like a very big baby. This is going to be a multi-part series. In this first episode, we will go into detail about the differences between the three main models of emergency parachutes. Of course, I'm aware that there are more types than just these three. The reason I chose to discuss these three specific types is that they're quite different from each other and that they cover like 95% of paragliding, hang gliding and paramotoring emergency chutes that are around. And I just wanted to point out that what most people are calling the round reserve or the round emergency parachute actually is not a round one if we look at all the emergency parachutes that are out there, also used for light aircraft, for skydiving, you name it. The one that is usually referred to as a round parachute is officially known as the pull-down apex parachute. If you look at it from the side, it is not really round. It looks more a bit like this, with a line in the center that is also connected to the bridle. If you look at it from the top, of course it is round. So for the purpose of this video, I will be referring to the pull-down apex parachute, which is a very popular one, also known as the PDA. I will just use it by the most commonly used name, the round parachute. Now, aside from these three main types that we're going to talk about, it's also important to know that there are a lot of subtypes, crossover types, if you will, that combine features from two or even three of these types. I'm not discussing these subtypes. We'll not be going into the pentagon or the square round parachute or any of the other subtypes. There are also a few exotics around that have a completely different way of working, that really expect you to cut away your main glider and that give you full control like a skydiving parachute. And a really short disclaimer, I'm going to be talking about general rules of thumb which apply to these three main types of emergency parachutes. I can assure you that you will be able to find exceptions to these rules of thumb. That's why they're called rules of thumb. If you find any nice exceptions that you think are worth sharing, please leave them down below in the comments. So just to make sure that we're all on the same page, a quick summary of how the emergency parachute works and how it's mounted. It's just a small package that's attached to a handle. The handle sticks out of your harness, or if you're flying a powered paraglider, it may be on your cage. Anyhow, you pull the handle, then you have the package in your hand, you throw it away, you watch it unfold, and you come down, usually hanging in your leg straps. There are a few ways to mount the reserve. The most common method you see in paragliders is that they are below the seat. They can also be behind the back, and they can be mounted in a smaller or bigger front container, which is usually attached to the main carabiners. For hang gliders, they're usually attached to a container on the chest, and for powered paragliders it goes that they also have the option to mount it on the cage, usually above the head. So the steps I discussed, they're applicable to all three types, but for the third type, the steerable reserve, there are some extra steps you have to take into account to get the most out of your reserve, and we'll get back to that later. And we're going to be comparing these three types of emergency parachutes on a few variables. We're going to talk about price, we're going to talk about weight, we're going to talk about opening time, we're going to talk about the amount of oscillation or stability, we're going to talk about steerability, and we're going to talk about the repacking time. So let's start with the most simple one, the PDA, or as it's commonly known, but is actually wrong, the round parachute. This is the simplest, most basic type. It is not very efficient, so usually for the same amount of weight, it has to be bigger. This means that it is also, in general, heavier and more bulky. It also has a tendency to oscillate, which means that if my little remote here is the pilot and this is the emergency parachute, that people are descending while the whole constellation is making this movement. Now, of course, if you're hitting the ground and you're going like this, it's a very nice and soft landing. But if you're going like this and you're swinging the other way while you're hitting the ground, you can imagine that it can be quite uncomfortable. Now, of course, this is a bit of an exaggerated example, but it is important to know that the round one, the PDA, has the biggest tendency to oscillate. Now, an improvement on that is the square. I'll show you a picture of that right here. It is, as the name suggests, an emergency parachute that has a square shape. It is a more aerodynamically efficient shape, which means that they can achieve the same kind of descent rate with less fabric. This means that in general, they will be lighter and they will be smaller than the PDA. They will in general also be opening faster and they will be more stable. So we will have way less of that swinging motion that you will see with the PDA. The sink rate, the speed with which you are descending while you're hanging on the emergency parachute, is comparable to the PDA. The downside of a square parachute is that they are, as we call, sideways tracking. If you're flying in zero wind conditions with a PDA, you will be descending like this. In zero wind conditions, if you fly a square emergency parachute, you will be moving in one direction or the other. This is a sacrifice they had to make it possible to have more stability, less of the oscillation. They are more expensive. Another minor downside is that they take a bit more time to repack. So repacking can be more costly as well. By the way, I hope you can see I'm really enjoying making this content for you guys. If you're looking for a way to support me and my work, I would really appreciate you leaving a comment, pressing the like button if you appreciate this video, and maybe consider subscribing. That way, YouTube knows that my videos are in demand and will show them to more people. Thanks for your help. And then we have the third type, the Rogallo. It is a completely different emergency parachute, as you can see. It has a really different shape, a shape that resembles the early days hang gliders, and it has brakes to be able to steer its direction. To be able to use this parachute to its fullest extent, to be able to steer it, to actually fly it somewhere, you need to take a few extra steps after throwing it. What you need to do first is retract your glider, because the chances of your main glider interfering with your Rogallo chute and then both flying down and accelerating you towards the ground is a risk of these emergency parachutes. You don't want that. So you have to retract your main glider or you have to release it. There are special quick out systems sold to actually very fast release your main glider. You just let it float away and retrieve it later. So you're only going down on your Rogallo wing. This is not mandatory, and the alternative is just pulling it in, but this can be quite a difficult task. You need to untwist your emergency parachute because it's guaranteed that there will be a few twists in it. Once you have untwisted, you have to release your brakes because this parachute comes out of the container in a position with the brakes on. It is slightly drifting in that case. It still works like a normal square parachute would, but you don't have the steering effect. You have to unlock it for that. So you have to reach up, get the brakes, pull them down, and start steering in a position a bit like this. You have the brakes above your head and you can actually steer the glider. So these are a few extra steps that you have to take in case you're using a steerable emergency chute. So if we compare this chute to the other ones, there are a few advantages, and as you've maybe already heard, also a few disadvantages. Let's start with the advantages. It has a faster opening rate. It has the lowest sink rate of all three types. It is steerable, so you can actually determine where you're going. It has way less oscillations, so it's really stable. And it allows you to be able to land into the wind because it is steerable. Now, of course, there are also a few downsides. If you keep it in the brakes stowed position, so the brakes are locked, it is tracking sideways. So it will be moving in one direction or the other. It is very complicated to pack. It takes about 2 to 3 to 4 times, depending on the experience of the packer, to pack this parachute compared to a PDA. And this has another downside you may not realize, but if you're flying at a location and you had to throw your reserve and you're down, you have all your stuff, you're completely okay and you want to go fly next day, this downside might make sure that you can't, because there's no one around that is able to repack your steerable emergency chute. Not our shops are able or willing to do this for you, and doing it yourself is very difficult, although it is possible. Another downside, these are very expensive. They can be 2 to 3 times as expensive as a PDA. And the last downside is that they are also heavier. And of course, as with the other parachutes, there are light versions available, but these cost even more money. So now you may be wondering, Bas, please tell me, which type is the best for me? I'm sorry, I can't answer that question. And I think nobody can. Maybe I should ask you a new question. Tell me what kind of accident you plan to have, and I will tell you what reserve best fits that accident. Now, it comes really down to personal preference and to making your own risk assessment. By the way, if you've not seen my video about how to take risks in a responsible manner, I can really recommend that you do that. I will leave a link right here. But yeah, you have to make your own risk assessment for this choice. As you see, there are a lot of pros of type A that are cons in type B. There is a lot to balance here. As a general rule of thumb, I would not recommend inexperienced pilots fly with a steerable reserve because of the downsides we discussed earlier. Of course, there are also, as with all things in our beautiful sports, a few beautiful myths and often asked questions and general tips that I can give you in choosing and using these 3 types of parachutes. And I will be going into more detail in the next episode, which I will publish next week on Friday. I would love to hear what you think about this episode. Please leave your thoughts in the comments down below. To conclude, YouTube is recommending this video for you, and the video down below is one that I recommend you watch. See you next time. See you in the air.